The imaginary number I is an integral part of any algorithm that uses sines and cosines, like the Fourier transform. But we are told that I is the square root of minus 1. Why is I the square root of minus 1? Any number multiplied by itself gives a positive result. Even my 9-year-old son knows that. So how can any number squared ever be negative? To find out, we're going to have to go back to basics and ask ourselves, what do numbers mean? Maths in general, and numbers in particular, are very abstract concepts. But we all learn numbers as young children. How do you teach children abstract concepts? You have to apply them to something real. So we teach them to count.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
As they grow older, we teach them addition and subtraction. Lavi, can you give 2 apples to Aviel?
1, 2.
How many apples do you have left?
4.
As they get older still, we teach them multiplication and division. Aviel, tell Lavi how many times more apples he has than you.
You've got twice as many apples as I have.
That's all fine and covers everything they need to know about maths, at least while they're young. But then we hit a problem. Aviel, can you give Lavi 3 apples?
1, 2.
Daddy, can you get me some apples?
So this method of teaching them numbers only covers the positive integers. We now need a new set of numbers, negative numbers, to express ideas like debt. Aviel doesn't have enough apples to give to Lavi, so he needs to borrow one. Aviel, catch! Aviel now owes me an apple, or we could say he has -1 apples. Counting apples is a great way of teaching children the abstract concept of numbers, but it does have its limitations. Especially if we're going to try and achieve an intuitive way of understanding how I squared could ever equal -1. So we need another way of looking at numbers, somewhere else where they affect the real world. In the field of geometry, for example. Just as there are 4 mathematical operators, addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, so there are 4 geometric transformations. Translation, rotation, scaling, and reflection. The 4 mathematical operators can be applied in the world of geometry to perform the 4 transformations. Addition and subtraction can translate an object. Addition moves the object to the right, and subtraction moves it back to the left again. Multiplication and division can be used to scale an object, making it larger or smaller. But in the world of geometry, multiplication and division are quite powerful, as they can perform other transformations apart from just scaling. For example, if we scale an object by multiplying it by -1, we can reflect that object. What about squaring a number? How could we represent that in geometric terms? Whenever we square a number, we could think of it as starting out with the unit square. That's a square whose width and height are both 1. And applying the same multiplication twice to that unit. So if I wanted to represent 2 squared, I scale the unit square by 2 and then by 2 again. What happens if I want to represent -2 squared? Again, we start with our unit square, only this time I'm scaling it by -2. The minus sign reflects the object, and the 2 scales it. Then, because we are squaring, I have to do the same again. The minus sign reflects the object, and the 2 scales it. This is one way of understanding why any negative number squared always gives a positive result. The 2 reflections always mean that the object ends up being back in the positive domain of numbers. If this is true, how can anything squared ever equal minus 1? In other words, if we ask the same question in a geometric way, what transformation can we perform twice to get from here to here using multiplication? Scaling doesn't help us, and neither does reflection, as the squaring operation always ends up reflecting the object back into the domain of positive numbers. Translation can only be done with addition or subtraction, so what's left? What transformation, when performed twice, can get me from here to here? Only rotation. I can rotate the object once by 90 degrees, and then again by another 90 degrees. The same transformation repeated twice, just as the squaring operation requires. Hang on a second. Where did my shape go on that first rotation? We're used to living in a world of 4 dimensions. The position of any object in our world can be described by 3 spatial coordinates, x, y, and z, and a 4th coordinate, which is time. However, in the abstract world of maths, we can have as many dimensions as we like. The only problem is we sometimes have trouble representing them when we try to draw them on a 2-dimensional piece of paper. So, as we only have 3 spatial dimensions to play with, I'm going to have to borrow one of those dimensions to represent this strange new dimension. For centuries, mathematicians suspected that this new dimension might exist. However, they were reluctant to believe it. René Descartes, the 17th century philosopher and mathematician who gave us the Cartesian coordinate system, wrote about it in 1637 and was rather derogatory about the idea. He disliked it so much that he called it the imaginary dimension, for he too was hard-pressed to believe in its existence. It wasn't until the 19th century and the work of Leonhard Euler on his famous identity that the imaginary dimension became more widely accepted. You can find out more about Euler's identity in another video of mine. I've placed the link in the description below. Any number in the imaginary dimension is known as an imaginary number and is given the symbol I. So, just as we have 1, 2, 3, etc. on the x and y axes, we have I, 2i, and 3i, etc. on the imaginary axis. In geometric terms, just as multiplying by minus 1 can be thought of as a reflection, so multiplying by I can be thought of as a rotation via the imaginary axis. So if I want to use a squaring operation to transform my unit square so that its length ends up as minus 1, I have to multiply it by I to rotate it by 90 degrees, and then by I again to rotate it by another 90 degrees. Therefore, I squared is a rotation of 180 degrees via the imaginary axis, which equals minus 1. And that is why I is the square root of minus 1. Now, you might think that imaginary numbers are just a load of abstract mathematical twaddle. And if so, you're in good company, as most of the eminent mathematicians who were born before the 19th century would agree with you. However, as I said at the beginning of the video, numbers are an abstract concept until you apply them to the real world, where it turns out that imaginary numbers can be very useful indeed. They enable us to solve all kinds of problems that were either difficult or impossible to solve before their discovery. For example, the 90-degree rotation of I makes them ideal for use with sines and cosines in very important algorithms like the Fourier transform. If you'd like to find out how, please visit my course on how the Fourier transform works. The link is in the description below. Do you have any questions about the imaginary number I and the world of complex numbers? Please ask in the comments below. If you would like to see more videos, visit my channel. Make sure to hit the subscribe button and set the bell notification so you know when a new video is available. Please consider supporting the making of these videos by becoming a patron.